Hey guys, this is how to become an astronaut. This week marks the 50th anniversary of the Apollo 11 mission to the moon, and NASA has announced plans to return to the moon by 2024 as a stepping stone to even more ambitious deep space exploration. To me, this period of time was an absolutely incredible leap in technological advancement. I mean, seriously, think about it. There were only 66 years between the first powered flight taken by humans and when a guy literally walked around on the moon. Like, seriously. Now, it sounds laughable today, but at this point, no one even knew if a human could survive a trip into space. It also didn't help that the very first rockets were not exactly the polished Elon Musk-approved versions that we have today. Instead, early plans called for a retrofitted ICBM, and you know, missiles aren't exactly designed with human safety in mind. Quite the opposite, actually. That's literally the opposite. Yeah. But luckily, they actually did continue to tweak the designs of spaceships to something a little bit more safety-oriented. Yeah, that would have been bad, actually, though. That would have been really bad. According to Warren North, one of the senior NASA officials on the original selection committee, their contingency plan, if there were no volunteers, was to reach out to prisons for some volunteers. Fortunately, there was no shortage of willing candidates. In fact, over 100 applied, most of whom were test pilots with the military. Now, that makes sense, right? I mean, who better to pilot a rocket than an actual pilot? However, NASA engineers began to realize that each astronaut would need more skills than just being good at flying. Obviously, being in peak physical condition was important, but candidates also needed to display above average levels of problem solving across multiple fields of studies. Of the initial candidates, 7 were chosen for NASA's first manned space missions, known as the Mercury 7. Now, they became the guinea pigs for NASA to test any and all scenarios they believed an astronaut might encounter in space.
Mars attacks! Knock, knock! Aliens! Ray gun!
I appreciate the commitment to that one, man. That was impressive.
The script clearly says Matt makes himself sound stupid.
Intense temperature chambers, simulators, and every astronaut's least favorite, the G-force centrifuge training in which they called the Beast. Now, this tested if the human body could even stay conscious when experiencing the multiple G's of force that an astronaut was expected to withstand. They were even the first to test the Vomit Comet Zero Gravity Aircraft Simulator. Doctors were actually afraid that people's organs might shut down. If you look at the old footage of those first zero gravity tests, all the astronauts are there laughing, having a good time. The cats they tested, though, not so much. After several successful Mercury flights, NASA moved on to Project Gemini. And yes, it's pronounced Gemini, not Gemini, because 1950s, I guess. This program is considered the middle child of the original NASA programs, and was how NASA learned to actually navigate and survive in space for extended periods of time. This is also where they worked on improving a pretty important little detail, how to re-enter and land. It's pretty important. With that, NASA was ready for Project Apollo. The crew, Buzz Aldrin, Neil Armstrong, and Michael Collins, only had 2 years to prepare for their mission. Now, while that might sound like a long time, there was a lot to accomplish. The crew spent months in a classroom, studying past missions, and learning the vehicles that they would be piloting. They went through simulation after simulation after simulation. In fact, Neil Armstrong actually crashed a lunar landing simulator, ejecting barely in the nick of time. Because the Apollo spacecraft were designed to land in the ocean upon re-entering the Earth's atmosphere, the Apollo crew needed to train on how to exit the capsule into inflatable life rafts while still wearing their spacesuits. First, they did this in a swimming pool, but eventually they started training in the Gulf of Mexico.
What happens if they miss the ocean?
Well, they actually did have contingency plans for that too, although it was like way more hardcore than you might think. So first of all, they had to train for survival in both the jungle as well as the desert. And by that, I don't mean like just for like a single day. They had to learn how to survive for extended periods of time. The astronauts learned how to build shelter, how to find food, what kind of animals are poisonous, that kind of training. You know, like Bear Grylls style. Remember, back in these days, there was no satellite imaging or GPS tracking. NASA could make an educated guess on where the astronauts would land, but there was a very real possibility that if something went wrong on re-entry, it would take some time to find the crew. These guys practiced every single detail about the mission. They ran various simulations for collecting rocks and soil samples, how to plant the flag in the ground, and obviously taking that first step down the ladder. Now I know, some of this stuff does sound pretty mundane, but can you imagine that if the first time when Neil Armstrong tried stepping out of the ship, he like, fell or something? I mean, come on, the whole world was watching. You don't wanna fall. One small step, So if you wanna become an astronaut today, there's some good news. Since NASA's inception, there have been a full 22 classes of astronauts. The downside though, is that for the most recent class of 2017, over 18,000 people applied, but only 12 were selected. Slightly worse odds than the 100 who applied for the first mission. Candidates then spend 2 years of basic training, going through a nearly identical regimen as the original crews. Spacewalk simulations and swimming pools, basic survival, and technical skills are all part of training. And now that we're no longer in a space race, all astronauts are required to learn at least conversational Russian.
It's Soviet Russia. Wait, it's not Soviet anymore.
You couldn't even finish the joke, man.
That was the joke.
So comrades, that is a look at how you can become an astronaut today, although there are of course other options. I hear SpaceX is hiring, or at least looking for volunteers. Anyway, thank you guys so much for watching this episode. If you're interested, definitely be sure to check out some more This Is right here, and make sure to subscribe to the channel, because if you don't, Matt will never realize his lifelong dream of being launched into space.
I'm gonna go so far into space.
How far, Matt?
All the space.
It's a lot of space.
All of it.